Hey guys, it's desk view again. That means I have something to show you, which I do quite a lot, and I'm going to try to do it as fast as I can while still, getting everything in there. G00DwillHUNT3R sent me yet again another box full of old computer awesomeness, and not every single one thing has to do with computer. And two of them are actually Apple only games, or I think it's three. I don't know, so I won't be able to use those, or actually one of them I might be able to. It depends, but anyway, I'm getting ahead of myself. But as always, there's a note here, so let's start with that. Of course, Mike, here's a decent amount of old games that you most likely won't be able to do much with. There's a few I can, but maybe you could do something with them. I just hate to see these games get thrown out. Me too. You know, even if I can't use them, I still like having them because they're really cool to look at. So just passing them along to another collector, even if you can only get one to work, I consider it a success. It's pretty much how I think of it too. G00DwillHUNT3R, yes. And yet again, thank you so much for this because it's awesome. Somebody's really surprised me too when I saw what they were. First off, we're going to start with the things that are not like actual computer stuff or computer games. And the first thing is this mouse. Yes, it's pretty big. I'll explain why in a minute. This is called the Snooper Booms Lang 2100, obviously denoting the DPI. And it's distributed by a company called BFG Technologies, which, I don't know, depends how much you're familiar with computer stuff. That applies to all of this, of course. But it's actually a Razer mouse. And this is a real Razer mouse, unlike that thing I have over there, which I've explained before. And the easy way to tell, unless you already know like I do, is right there. It even says Razer. Razer Incorporated. Yeah, there you go. And it's actually a trackball mouse, and I can actually use this on the computer because it's USB instead of that weird connector a lot of these trackball mice use. Now, even to this day, I still like trackball mice because of the feel they give over like a laser one. I'm not saying it's superior to a laser one, I just said it. I like the feel you get from it, you know? I always found these to be very nice for strategy games because you get that nice big sweeping movement. You don't have to pick the mouse up all the time. But as you might have guessed from the name and the shape of it and how big it is and the look, it's meant for like first-person shooters, which is fine. You can use this for anything. It's got two buttons on the sides. It's all nice. I'm going to use this a lot, let me tell you. It's bound to be better than that thing. So, yeah, that's really cool. It's got a longer wire, too, which will be nice. Now, the next thing that is not computer-related, well, there's another one after this, is this. Yes, now, I already had the game. He actually sent this to me a while ago, loose. There it is right there. But I didn't have the case, and I tried for a while to look around and see if I could get the case and the manual by itself. Not likely to happen. I'd have to get the whole entire thing itself, so that wasn't working out good. And he even said he thought he saw it like that, and he said he could get it for me, and there you go. So now I have another complete GameCube game. So I only have one loose one still, that Mario Party game, which is fine. So I forgot how thick the manual is for this game. Like I mentioned before, Melee is still my personal favorite in the series. So, there you go. Nice. And I can get that off very easy. So, there you go. Nice. And the next thing that is not computer related in the slightest, but the rest is actually a Dreamcast game, a very good one. Monaco Grand Prix. If you've never played this, I recommend it. It's very nice. Just know you can't throw cars around in this like you can in a Need for Speed game or an arcade game, like Test Drive 6, which is also on the Dreamcast. You actually have to make use of the analog triggers, brake and accelerate, and be careful with it. It doesn't take that long to get used to, and once you do, it's really fun. I recommend, too, watching the really old Classic Game Room review of this, which is really good. Of course, I'll be doing a video on this a while from now for my Dreamcast series, which, in fact, Dreamcast is right there next to me. Yeah. Got it plugged into my little CRT TV. Anyway, next thing is actually Sega related, believe it or not. I just put these in any random order, so whatever. Sega Touring Car Championship. This is also in the Dreamcast, by the way. I mean, not the Dreamcast, the Saturn. And I highly recommend if you're playing the Saturn version to use the steering wheel. Works a lot better than using the D-pad. But yeah. I actually forgot for the longest time this was on the computer, but so was Sega Rally. And that should mean I can run this, even though it's Windows 95. I've already explained before in previous videos of this kind of thing that Windows 95 is coming kind of up in the air. But it's a pretty fun game. It's got a lot of nice cars in it. Got some Alfa Romeos even. So it's all good. I don't know why they have to point out you can use automatic or manual transmission, but hey, why not? And the computer version here even has network play, which obviously does not work anymore. Or maybe some people have some reverse engineered servers like they do for Phantasy Star Online. Who knows? But yeah, it's pretty cool. And the not long-lived Sega Racing branding right there didn't last long. Next is one of the ones that surprised me the most to see. I love this game, but I know from watching Spoonie, it's extremely difficult to get working, and he still to this day has never revealed his secret. So I'm going to have to try and see if I can figure out how he did it. Even though it doesn't say 2 on here, this is actually the second one. Phantasmagoria 2, A Puzzle of Flesh, my favorite one in the series, of the two games in the series. The first one's really good too. Now, this is one of those games, without going on about it forever, I do want to talk about it. Most people think it's Mortal Kombat and Night Trap, which is on the Sega CD, which actually was supposed to be a movie, by the way, a VHS game movie, caused all the controversy, which it did, and led to the ESRB rating system, which they did have a hand in it, but it wasn't just those. It was also the first Phantasmagoria and this one. The first Phantasmagoria was very controversial because of its violence and stuff in that. This one took it to a whole new level. It's a very weird game in itself, but it's also, well, I'll show you in a second. But here on the back is an advertisement for the first one, which is a very good game. All things considered, the first one, Phantasmagoria, is actually a better game than this one. Just saying. But my personal favorite is this one because of the ridiculousness of it. I mean, this is where awesome quotes like, "I heard that, Curtis," came from. Yeah, you work at WinTech, go to the Dream Tree, which is like tchotchkes from Office Space, and you also have the Borderline Club, which brings me to my point. Wait, not that one. There you go. It's easier to see. Yes, it's on multiple discs, of course. I'll explain why it's hard to get this one working, particularly in a second. But here is the precursor to the ESRB rating system, which there's actually one or two other games I have here I'm going to show you that have the same rating. But they actually put the rating on every disc on itself. It's not on the game jewel case itself, though. And yes, this basically has to do with the Borderline Club, and why when he did his playthrough of it, he couldn't show certain things. Yes. It's a pretty twisted game, but it's pretty fun. But, yeah, I like it. It's hard, very hard, but that's the way Sierra Adventure games were. Now, two particular reasons why this is hard to get running. It's an FMV game. I've already explained those are difficult to get running anymore, although the X-Files one works is pretty easy. The main reason this is difficult to run is because it uses a very old and odd version of QuickTime. That's basically the major hurdle. So, you can get past that, you'll be fine. The hardest thing above all, and I still have not found anything on the internet even explaining how to do this, apparently no one's asked this question, even let alone made a forum thread on it, is how do you record an FMV game? No program I've ever tried works. I'll figure it out eventually. Anyway, Descent. Here's one of the games I mention every now and then. I used to have a few games that got destroyed by accident, and this was one of them, the original one, the first one, which is my favorite one. Although, luckily, GOG got a hold of it, and I was able to get those on there, so I have every single Descent game from GOG, but now I have this one. Free 60 degrees 3D environment. Yes, this is exactly like the one I used to have. First one's my favorite one. I can't explain why it just is. It's not because it's the first one. And if you've never seen it, there you go. It's basically like a one of those spaceship combat flight simulator thing deals. Except for I like this a lot more. It's like Free Space, if you're familiar with that game series. It's really fun. This is one of the power-up orbs you get in the game, and the CD looks like a big version of that. There's not much else to see here, really. Now, I haven't done a video on this because, while I can record it, unfortunately, stuff gets cut off for no apparent reason, so until I take care of that, that's why I haven't done a video on this game, even though I've had the GOG version for quite a while. So I'll get that figured out. This might actually help, because GOG, they do a great job, but they do have to alter the games in some ways to give them to work. So maybe that might be part of it. I don't know. I'll see. I got a lot to do with all these games here. Now, this is a cool one, I'm telling you right now, it has nothing to do with that Indiana Jones movie that so many people hate, you know, it has the same name on it. This came out way before that movie was even an idea. The Crystal Skull. A mythic Aztec adventure. Yes, it's another adventure game. It's not full-on FMV, but it has FMV sprite actors in it. Now, a quick explanation of this. Yes, it's Maxis. This Crystal Skull here, the design and look of it, looks exactly the same as the one that's in that movie, if you've seen it. Now, this whole Crystal Skull thing was a thing before that movie existed. That's also where this game gets it from. So, it's one of those things, kind of like the Eastern Island heads. But yeah. The place is ancient Mexico, and the fate of the Aztec Empire wrestled with you. Well, I better get my act together then and save the place. It's actually pretty decent looking, for considering when it came out at the time. This is as old as Phantasmagoria 2 is. Talk to a variety of characters with unique talkbox interface. Yes, that's one of the things I've heard of this. This video might go on a little while, by the way. And it uses Macromedia, which is actually a good sign. I might be able to get this to work. It's another multi-disc game, of course, but whatever. This is one of those Maxis games most people don't remember. Of course, they didn't make it. They only published it, but still. distributed it. Next one, this is pretty cool. This is one most of you might not be familiar with, even if you know Quake. This is, well, I'll explain in a second. Aftershock for Quake, Deluxe Edition, 50 exclusive, never-before-seen levels. Requires registered version of Quake. So there's the question, do you need Quake to run it? Yes, you do. And here's one of the other ones I mentioned that has the precursor to the ESRB rating system. I actually can't remember what the letters stand for, RSAC. I used to, but I can't. It's been too long. But anyway, this is the closest thing I can compare to, maybe you might be familiar with, is Master Levels for Doom 2. It's like a bunch of the best levels in a compilation to expand your game. It's basically an expansion. It's got a really cool picture, too, if you look past all the letters. So there's a couple things we can look at here. Two of these I remember by name, Dark Hole and Night Sight. Dead Meat, I think I remember. But you also have an editor in this too, which you can make your own levels, which is cool. Look at this, easy online help with hints, tips, and cheat codes and other helpful information. So basically they're saying if you blow it, Quake, we can help you cheat. Yeah. So you can't play this without the original Quake, which, okay, whatever, fine, that's alright. I still have to get that again too. But anyway, yeah, this is pretty nice. They got some really good levels in this, and there's not much to see in here, but I do want to show this. This is another one. I actually used to have this one, Tremor from Quake. I used to have Aftershock also, this here. But you can also get these separate. This is the deluxe one, so it comes with the editor and the maps. That's what I'm getting at. So it's got these together. And for some reason, because you know this totally has in common with the rest of this, Pro Pool 3D. Yes, or billiards, if you like calling it that. I don't. There you go. And unfortunately, here's one of the ones I can't play because one of the discs is missing, but that's okay. It's still cool to have. Another game in the Might and Magic series. This is Might and Magic 9. Yes, not Final Fantasy 9, but Might and Magic 9. Yes, New World Computing, which has got a sword going through the earth, put out by the Freedio organization, not the Freedio console. Yeah. This is a really nice one. I've actually played this before. I might just get it off of GOG, but yeah. Like I said, it requires two discs. The installed disc is missing, but oh well. That's okay. There is another Might and Magic game in here, but I haven't gotten to that yet. Now this is pretty cool. Some of you might not have ever heard of this. Bleem! Play hundreds of PlayStation games on your PC. Get next generation gameplay today. Remember, this is way back, not now. Higher resolution, more detail, richer color. Now, you might have heard of this for the Dreamcast. They put out a couple of altered versions for the Dreamcast where you can play like Gran Turismo 2 on the Dreamcast and the first Metal Gear Solid on it, and they upgraded the resolution, and they also put anti-aliasing in there and makes it look better. That's basically what this is, although what this really does is you put a PlayStation game in your computer and this allows you to play it. So essentially, it's kind of like an emulator in a way, but I think this might actually work better than the PSXE emulator. I'm not sure. You don't really need a massive requirements even for back then. I still remember this stuff. You do need a 3D accelerator card, which that's everyone has that now. Enhanced graphics, yes, see, as you see thing here. It takes the standard resolution of PlayStation games, which that's not actually fully true because PAL games run at a different resolution. And you can expand it to 640 by 480 or 800 by 600. Wow, that's what Trespasser runs at. Anyway, yeah. And the one for the Dreamcast, by the way, is called Bleemcast. The thing they don't mention here is you're going to be using a friggin' keyboard to play PlayStation games. Oh, fun. And here it's trying to show you a comparison of the enhanced visuals. So on the left we have what the PlayStation normally looks like, rough and jagged. And that's what this does. And I'm not kidding, it actually can make it look that much better. The manual's pretty thick too, but that's basically just explaining how you work this thing. I only have one PlayStation game still, the X-Files FMV game, so I'm probably going to try it out with this, but this is pretty cool. I usually see if a lot of PlayStation games I like for very cheap, so I might get one or two of them and try it out with this. It'll be fun. I could play them on my computer in better resolution, although I can do that with the emulator, too, but whatever. So the next one is an expansion, and I can actually use this because I have the other one, or is it the first Warcraft I think he sent me a while back? I don't know. It's sitting over there. Anyway, I've played this before, too, in the past. Warcraft 2, Beyond the Dark Portal expansion set. Yeah, I miss when they used to do expansions. It's better than what they do nowadays. Anyway, requires a full Warcraft 2 to play. Basically gives a whole pirate theme to everything, as you can see here. But you get 24 new scenarios, two different storylines, one for the orcs, one for the humans, of course, 50 custom maps, and all kinds of other nice stuff. And to be fair, the 3D cinematics in this actually did look better than a lot of games at the time. So yeah. more of the same, really, which there's nothing wrong with that. And just the shape of this looks like, it's got a cool kind of like ancient rock embossed thing on the disc here. And you could buy Blizzard swag. I think that's what they call it nowadays. Yeah, t-shirts and stuff. I'd go for the mouse pad because one, it looks really cool, and two, it's a nice big one. But yeah, good luck trying to get one of those nowadays. Probably find it on eBay for $80. Anyway, now here's one of the two Mac games. And I'll admit, I was actually hoping this was a Windows game so I could play because it's a really awesome game, but oh well. The other Apple game, I might have a chance to get running because of some things I've read in the past, but this one, no, it's too recent. But this also means, for the first time ever, I finally own two Mac-only games. I have a few others, like the original Diablo games, which are both Windows and Mac. I actually have Sims 3 on the floor over here to the right, which is a pretty damn new game, and that's both Windows and Mac. But this is Mac only. There's a couple things to give it away besides the little Mac logo up here. Black and White 2 is a very good game, by the way. If you can get a chance to play it, I highly recommend it. It's also on Windows. This is one of the clues right here. That's one. Lionhead Studios, who you might have heard of, that's the ones that put out Fable. This is back when they actually, you know, kept their promises, what they said was going to be in a game. It's kind of hard to explain what this is, but it's a little bit like that game that came out a few years ago called From Dust. It's the closest thing I could compare it to. Actually, the last game I'm going to show you is kind of like that. But here's the major thing that tips you off it's a Mac-only game, besides that it doesn't say Windows anywhere, is the Cheeto picture and the Mac OS thing right there, and that and the design of this, yes. Because at the time, I can't remember if it was called Cheetah or Leopard is what the name of the operating system was for Apple computers at the time. So, yeah. Funny thing is, this is pretty actually low requirements for an Apple computer, which nowadays is completely reversed. But since I can't play this at all, there's no chance, I can still show you this. You know, it's funny because a while ago, about a half a year ago, I saw in a place that was closing down, like this thrift store, they actually had an Apple computer for $40 used. It was one of those ones that had the colors, you know, you might have been familiar with in schools. It was missing its mouse, but everything else worked. And I was actually going to buy it and get a mouse off the internet, and I wish I did. I could have played this. I could have had an Apple computer too for the first time, my own Apple computer, but no. It's a little bit like a combination of games. It's a little bit like The Sims, a little bit like From Dust. It's got a couple of things thrown in there, combination. It's got a pretty thick manual too. It only is on one DVD though, so there you go. And I just realized something else. This is actually got the PAL rating system and the ESRB rating system on it, and it's got the Australian rating system on it. It's got all three. So when you have an Apple game, it covers all the bases. I think Black and White 2 is on GOG, so I might get it there. I realize I'm almost at 20 minutes here. Hunter Hunted, this is not one I'm very familiar with. I think it's another adventure game, I'm not sure, but on the back we have an advertisement for a PC fighting game. Yeah, how many of those exist? Not many. I'm not familiar with this at all. I have heard of it. So if I can get it to work, that'll be nice. Looks interesting, though. This is from 1996 also. Here's another Heroes game. This one I can run because it's got all the discs. This is, if not the best game in the series, it's one of the best. TB mentions it all the time, but it really is. I've played it too. This is the complete one, which gives you two expansions. Heroes 3 of Might and Magic, Collector's Edition. And you get, of course, regular Heroes 3, but you also get... I gotta look at this because it's too small for me to see. I still can't read it. There's that one, and then the other two here. Armageddon's Blade and Shadow of Death. I feel like Grub Gun dealing with this camera sometimes, how his used to be. Shadow of Death is the one I remember more, but it's a very nice game, very fun. And it's on two discs, of course, and of course you have in here some more stuff. Whatever. That's nice. Here's another game I'm not very familiar with, but this one shouldn't be that difficult to get working. Darkened Sky. It's one you might hear about every now and then people bring up. It seems pretty interesting. It's got some Tomb Raider feel to it. That's about what I remember of it. Wield Magic, Solve Ancient Mysteries, and blah 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 blah. And Kick Monster Butt. Alright, that's the thing that sells me on it right then and there. It's got Alienware logo on it. But yeah, it's a pretty interesting one. This one's got both its discs too. I like the kind of like charcoal artwork on the here. You can see the, like the strokes in the art. That's pretty cool. So there's that. Now we're almost at the end here. Here's the other one. It's an Apple game, but this one I might be able to get working. It's kind of up in the air right now. But someone you might have heard of, Don Bluth, did the animation for this, yes, which he's got some pretty cool looking art design aesthetic. I don't know what to call it, really. But you can see some of it down here, because I probably won't be able to get this game to work. Yeah, bit like Dungeons & Dragons and all that. And you get a little bit of a story here. Apparently Kimberly from Power Rangers has been taken. You have to rescue her. Space Ace, yes. I've heard of this game quite a few times. But yeah, and that's the obvious tip-off right there for Macintosh computers. Back when they used to call it Macintosh. Now they just call it Mac. It sounds weird because every now and then I actually say Macintosh. I still find that's better. And a game I really like, this is when I started getting into the Grand Theft Auto series. I played the first one before this way back when, but I didn't really think much of it. This one looks better and plays better than the first one. So, yeah, it's slightly easier to navigate too, it's just better in general. Now, for a while, Rockstar actually offered the first and second Grand Theft Auto for free, the computer version, of course, off their site, but they don't do it anymore for whatever reason. But yeah, this is a nice one. It's pretty good on the Dreamcast too, but I still prefer the computer version, it works slightly better. And this actually still has its map, which is very awesome, because the first one and the second one are very difficult to navigate. Just look at that. Anyway. So there you go. GTA 2, which this kind of reminds me of Die Hard with a Vengeance, because they were using taxis all the time in it. So there you go. And now, the best for last, and also the heaviest and the biggest one. This is the one that surprised me the most, and made me the most excited, I guess. This is one I cannot use at all because I don't have a floppy disk drive. I have not for over 12 years now, but it's still awesome to have because it's a Maxis game in the big box. So, it's always awesome. And this is a game I've always wanted to play because of how complex it is. Wait until I show you the manual and you'll see what I mean. There's a lot of shit in this box. Sim Earth. Yes, the living planet, to give it its subtitle. That's the old Maxis logo. And we can see on here how complicated of a game this is. You can even see the Earth's core. You can terraform the planet, you can do all this, move mountains. It likes to point out that move mountains thing so many times in this. There's actually also a little piece of paper with a letter from the president of Maxis, fully admitting there's bugs in the game. They tried their best to get them all out, but there might still be some. You'll never see that these days. They'll just make it out to be the gamer's fault. Oh yeah, we did our best job, but it's all you guys' fault. You'll know what you're doing with the game. That's the way they do it these days. Here's the thick-ass manual. Still going, still going, still going, still going. There's about 225 pages in this, including a scientific breakdown of all the facts of the Earth, the Moon, and the planets in the solar system. That's pretty cool in itself. And in the back here, you get a tree to figure out how the hell all this shit works. Erosion, greenhouse effect. Do you get what I mean by this is a complicated game? That's why I've always wanted to play it. I like the old Maxis logo. You don't see it that often. There's a couple other things in here, too. I'm not going to dwell on it. That don't really belong here, but whatever. King's Quest Collection manual, essentially. Some of these games like this, you really do need this to play it, because it tells you to look for certain things. Myst Troubleshooting Guide. A couple of registration cards, which have never been filled out, which is kind of cool. This disc is not in here, by the way. But a kind of demo preview for an adventure game, Star Trek Next Generation Final Unity, which is much like the one on the Sega Genesis Mega Drive, which is called Echoes in Time. It's not exactly like it, but it's pretty much as close as it can be. All these always were pretty much like lost episodes. So, yeah, and you can see what it looks like here. I've never played this particular version of it. But, yeah, it looks pretty okay, visually, for the time. Nice to point out the SVGA shit. It's got a Maxis. Well, we'll take a real quick look at that, I guess. And Windows version, system information, manual addendum, and quick start guide. So they couldn't fit everything they wanted to in the original thick one, so they had to put it in there. But this is what I really wanted to show you. This is why I can't play this game. First of all, this is more what like I'm more familiar with. I mean, I grew up with the other kind towards the end, too, the really, truly floppy ones, but this is the ones I remember most. Mainly for saving Word documents, you know. Disk 1, install it. Disk 2, to play it. Doom also came this way, too. I intentionally got the disc version, the CD version way back when, but this is it. This is the mother right here. 1.2 megabyte high density disc. This is what a lot of games used to come on. Like the old Ultima games for a long while. This is where the term floppy disc actually came from. these ones right here. They're a lot more fragile than these, obviously. But I just love seeing these. It's cool to have one of these again. It's really nice. Yeah, don't hold as much information as these, though. Again, they're a lot more fragile. But these are so cool. This is what we used to use. And real quick, because this is the last thing here, we'll take a quick look at the Maxis catalog here, because it might be kind of funny to see some of these you've never seen before. Here's one, A-Train. Never played it myself, but it's a strategy game, of course. That's what Maxis was always known for. That's the price of the game way back when. $70, and I forgot to say this at the beginning. Sorry if you can hear the heavy rain. It's been doing it all day. Nothing I can do about that. Sim Ant, a game I thought was ridiculous, and then until I played it, it's actually really fun. They got quotes from random people like Newsweek, and of course, Sim Earth gets a quote from CNN and Time. This is what Sim Earth cost when it was brand new way back when. Yep. 70. Apparently, it was also on the Amiga. The original SimCity. RoboSport, a game I know of, but many people forget about. Again, regular SimCity. RoboSport, Sim Earth for Windows. And a bunch of books. Strategy guides and all kinds of stuff. Notice Sim Earth appears here quite a few times. Yeah. So that was pretty cool. It's nice to have all this in here. I have a truly complete Sim Earth. I think even Lazy Game Reviews, or as his username used to be, Freakin' D, would even be impressed with this. He's got Sim Earth too, though. Back when I used to watch him, I actually asked him if he had it, and he does. So there you go. That is Sim Earth, the one that surprised me the most out of all this stuff here. Pretty cool. And it's the heaviest, and it's pretty much what made the box weigh down in a high wind. So there you go. I have another cool big box computer game I can proudly display. Yes. We're up there along with Tomb Raider and that Warcraft game. So that's awesome. Now, of course, I have a lot to do with these games and try to get all the ones I can working. And if I can actually get a few of them working, I might do maybe one video today on them. So there you go. That's it. Sorry if this was long. This is the second time me doing this, and it's slightly shorter. But whatever. I think it's pretty interesting. And I admit, I didn't say this at the beginning either. I was going to. I did in the other take. Is that I understand that many of you, if you're not into computer games at all, didn't play stuff on a computer, you never have, or even now, and you don't get why I'm excited by a lot of these particular games, you know, you don't really get the point of it, like, say, this one, but, you know, I still think it's pretty interesting, because a lot of these, you don't see stuff like this anymore, or, you know, the look of it and anything like that, so that kind of makes it interesting, too, you know? So, that's it for now. Thanks for watching and listening. Again. Thanks very much to G00DwillHUNT3R, Justin, for sending me this. I appreciate it, and he's right. Even if it doesn't work, I still enjoy it anyway. We're actually working on my bookshelf over there, just to mention this, to have a way to display all these awesome-looking computer games, which I have a ton of my own alone, even before I got any from him. So there's a lot to show. So when I ever get that done, I will do a video on that and show you that. So it's something I've been working on for a while now. So that's it, and I will see you later.